Now stains. Recent exam we had AIIMS mein three stains were there. November 2007 discussion. Let us talk once more about stains. This is the India Inc. staining of the Cryptococcus neoformans. Quick buzzwords. Mycetamine stain not only pneumocystis carinii, doctor, even Cryptococcus it is important. It is the one which is being used. Then Candida, you can do gram staining where it turns out to be gram positive. And this is a chest radiograph which is showing miliary densities in both the lung fields with the presence of a pus filled walled cavity. Talk about histoplasmosis, doctor. And sometimes histoplasma also can cause a single pulmonary nodule also. And it can cause a snowstorm appearance, acute histoplasmosis on the CT. And it can sometimes cause this kind of single pulmonary nodule even on the CT. And methylamine silver stain is also used for the staining of the histoplasma capsulatum fungi is what has to be remembered. And what is that peculiar feature of histoplasma called? Thermal dimorphism. Why is it called as? Because the mold form, it exists at 25 degrees Celsius, yeast form at 37 degrees Celsius. Histoplasma is called thermal dimorphism. Then in open lung biopsy, if you are suspected in that given case of multinodules histoplasma and had taken a open lung biopsy tissue, how do you stain it? This is the FA stain which will show the numerous yeast cells of the histoplasma. Capsulatum is what need to be remembered. Now what are all the stains used for the pneumocystis carinii and pneumonia, doctor? If you have got a bronchoalveolar lavage fluid, you are suspecting pneumocystis clinically, what do you do? Methylamine silver stain, toluidine blue, crizal violet and the Reed James stain, they are all the ones which are being used. This is a classical example of a bronchial wash in a HIV positive individual. Toluidine blue has been used in order to make out the pneumocystis carinii cysts. And also you can see the dot like thickening of this cyst classically with the methylamine staining which had been done over here, methylamine silver. Now let's go to the next question. I think every PGI exam Woodland will be there. You must go like Florence Nightingale to write the exam to be very sure about it. So what is importance of that in Tinea versicolor? Tinea versicolor typically caused by Molissesia furfur, all of you know very well. Now the question is, it causes these hypopigmented patches. Suppose if the patient goes into the sunshine, so whole body tans, even these hypopigmented patches tan? No, they don't tan, the whole body tans but they don't tan. Then spaghetti meatball appearance of the tinea versicolor, all of you know very well. So that is one place where wood lamp examination can help to detect. Now let us talk about the Rhinosporidium seaberi. Do you come across in India? Definitely in South India it can be in one of the epidemic. Which is that anti-lepra drug which is also used for Rhinosporidium? Dapsone is the one which is having a lot of application. So Rhinosporidium causes a chronic granulomatous disease and you can see the presence of the multiple spores of the Rhinosporidium over here. It can cause the polyposis in the nasal cavity, conjunctiva, oral cavity, etc., etc. I'll give you a short case presentation. A 35-year-old resident of Uttar Pradesh, fisherman by occupation, comes with a polypoidal lesion in the urethral polypoid lesion, and also he has got a polypoid lesion which is there in the causing nasal obstruction. Now here nothing you are seeing in the mouth, doctor, see the nose. So this is the place, lateral wall of the right nasal cavity is the place where you are able to see the polypoidal lesion. So this is a classical example of Rhinosporidium seaberi, and when the lesion had been taken you can see the presence of the multiple spores. There's a reason, what are the answers? It's a fungus, and it is in the coastal India very well prevalent, and dapsone is the one which is commonly used in the management of it, and even electrocautery, radical surgery, they all are required for the polypoid lesions. What is pneumocystis carinii? It is a fungus, it is gram positive. Is it fungus? Yeah, I mean there is always a confusion, fungus or protozoa, they keep on what you call debating on that. Now disinfectants and sterilizing agents, common question in the exam. So glutaraldehyde, formaldehyde and ethylene oxide are spironticidal. phenol and cresol are basically the ones that they have very little effect on the spores and pseudomonas. Phenol is bactericidal, chlorine has no effect on the spores at all. And what is that anti-infectivity score? Riedel-Walker coefficient is the one which you commonly use to know the efficacy of the disinfectant. Microcytic hypochromic anemia, where do you come across? In Ancylostoma diadenale, Nicator americanus, you can come across hookworm infections. Whereas the Diphyllobacterium latum, the fish tapeworm, long one, it can lead to megaloblastic anemia rather than microcytic anemia. Let us talk about the entamoeba and its cousins. Entamoeba has a lot of cousins. All of them are not pathogenic. Some of them look very similar to entamoeba. So out of that, if you take DISPAR, one of the options given, it looks very similar morphologically to that of the entamoeba histolytica. How can you then differentiate? It is only by the immunological differentiation you have to differentiate between the two. So this is the periodic acid shift stain, which is showing the presence of the tetranucleate cysts of the entamoeba histolytica, as all of you know very well. And immunoperoxidase stain can be used for the tophozoid recognition also. And there is the E. coli, I mean entamoeba coli is there, it is not entamoeba histolytica. So you can see the number of nuclei which are typically located. And out of all the species, histolytica is the one which is considered to be the invasive species. Most of them are non-invasive in nature. And it is the galactosyl neuraminic acid lectin is the one which will be useful to differentiate the entamoeba nana from that of the histolytica. So what are the various non-pathogenic amoebae that you have, doctor? Entamoeba DISPAR and coli and nana, these are all the various species. Now what is the age limit for eloping in this country, doctor? 21 years for boy and how many? 18 years, sir? Is it increased or decreased nowadays? No, no change. Good. So what are the powers of the first class magistrate? First of all, a judge's car cannot be stopped by traffic police. At least few privileges to become a judge, right? So I had one patient who is a judge of a criminal court. So when she comes, my OPD will be studded with the people and they are all below the poverty line patients. So suddenly she walks in, sir, I have seen your MD from prestigious Nizam's Institute of Medical Sciences, sir. So that's fine, you need to wait because all my TB, Pullama, LMA are all waiting. Since a long time, they may collapse and have hemoptysis in my own clinic. So, but at the same time, there is a VIP syndrome. You have to take care of your criminal court judge because a traffic police himself cannot stop. What can a poor MD doctor can do? He himself, he is much weaker species, right? So can a doctor's car cannot be stopped? It can be stopped by anybody. Even a beggar in a street can come and stand and say that you are being summoned to stop your vehicle. So we are actually like goats, doctor. Doctors are fundamentally very expected also by the society to be very soft and receiving to anyone. So let us talk about the class one magistrate. So chief judicial magistrate can imprison up to 7 years and fine can be unlimited, all your wealth can be taken by him. First class magistrate up to 3 years, 5,000 is the fine. Second class magistrate up to 1 year and 1,000 is the fine. You must be very sure which magistrate to send. Now organophosphate poisoning, all of you know, will cause acetylcholine esterase enzyme to become denatured and it will cause irreversible phosphorylation of it. That's the reason you have to give the auxin as early as possible, pralidoxin, before it has undergone a irreversible damage. That is the most important dictum. And why do you give atropine, doctor? It is not for antagonizing nicotinic effects of excess acetylcholine. It is only to antagonize the muscarinic effects of the excessive acetylcholine which occurs in the OP poisoning patient is what has to be remembered. MacNaughton's law and insanity, all of you know very well. Now myasthenia gravis commonly involves the extraocular muscles, diplopia, ptosis, they are all the presenting features. So levator palpebrae is the one which is commonly affected. Then comes the facial expression, mastication, swallowing, speech, they become affected. Finally the neck muscles, muscles of the shoulder, flexors of the hip, they are less frequent. Now a lot of questions come, is the weakness proximal or distal? is the weakness is symmetrical or not? How are the deep tendon reflexes? Is the pupil affected or not? 4 points you have to talk like a DM neurology student, doctor. Usually proximal symmetric will be classically there. If you do deep tendon reflexes or sensory examination by principle in that patient of weakness, it should be normal. Then only you should entertain the diagnosis of myasthenia. Myasthenic process is happening at NMJ, neuromuscular junction. Why should sensory system should get affected? Why should DTR should get affected? Not required. So that's the reason, doctor. They are typically normal. Weakness of the facial muscles is almost always present, and there can be a mild ptosis because of the presence of extraocular weakness. Bulbar muscles, swallowing, etc., etc., they all can become affected. Chewing, the jaw may be hanging down. These are all the problems. When are the neck muscles got affected? Flexors of neck or extensors of neck, which are much more affected. Neck flexors are usually affected more than that of the neck extensors, is the carry home message. Upper limbs are involved more than that of the lower limbs. Between upper limbs, deltoids and extensors of the wrists and fingers are the ones which are most affected. Triceps is more likely to be affected than that of the biceps, is what has to be remembered. Now coming to the lower limb muscles, hip flexors, quadriceps, hamstrings, they are the ones which are commonly involved, whereas the dorsiflexors or plantiflexors are less commonly involved. So gravity, anti-gravity, which muscles are affected first and are they proximal, distal? These are the common issues for the examiner. Finally, diaphragm can become affected in respiratory failure, ventilator dependence, etc. They all need to be anticipated if it is not taken care of the myasthenic process. Then let us talk about the severe acute respiratory syndrome, SARS. Typically, it is the coronavirus which has got this wonderful shape, membrane glycoprotein with all the spikes of the glycoprotein. Aerosols is the common method by which transmission occurs. Even fecal oral was contemplated as a possible method, even sewage or water, but aerosols are much more common. How does the patient present himself, doctor? Just like pneumocystis carniae leads to the interstitial involvement with pneumonia, acute respiratory distress, with type 1 respiratory failure, even SARS will also present fatally. Incubation period is only 2 to 7 days. Headache, myalgia, sore throat can be initial features. Leukopenia can very much occur. Then the saturation of oxygen falls less than 95% with type 1 respiratory failure. Liver enzymes become elevated. There is no effective treatment, and ribavirin is not effective, unlike the bronchiolitis where it is still effective, is what has to be remembered. Pneumocystis carniae, steroids are effective, but not in the case of the SARS, at least, is what has to be remembered. Now, which agents are basically having anti-cancer nature in our food? Vitamin C, vitamin D, and also selenium, they are the common agents, ascorbic acid also. Whereas the dietary nitrates become converted to nitrites, and nitrites in turn are converted into nitrosoic compounds, which are basically carcinogenic in nature, is what has to be remembered. Let us talk about candida. Is candida is a risk factor for is pregnancy is a risk factor? Very much. So we need to remember, candida is a normal commensal, but not a normal resident of skin. Oh, mouth, vagina, etc. It can be a normal commensal, not in the skin. Then there can be involvement of the bladder with the thick candida. In such scenario, amphotericin infusion need to be, irrigation need to be done to take care of the cystitis caused by the candida. So infancy, old age and pregnancy, they are all important risk factors to develop the candidiasis. Meningitis, how will the CSF look like? What is the age group? What type of agent will come? Common topics for the exam, you must be doubly sure, doctor. No big surprise in the exam hall. So acute pyogenic meningitis, the CSF become cloudy. And exudates will be evident on the leptomeninges typically. And this is how a cloudy spinal fluid, if you are a seasoned AMC house surgeon, you will recognize even before laboratory report comes whether your patient has a viral or bacterial meningitis by repeatedly seeing the CSF samples, right? So cloudy. Then typically exudates, which are at the basal level. Then why we are worried about basal meningitis caused by tuberculosis or H influenza, doctor? Because that is the point where you have all the lower cranial nerves which will be exiting out. 8th, 9th, 10th, etc. Suppose if the 8th got involved by this exudates, what will happen? Deafness will occur. That's the reason any child who recovered from H influenza meningitis must be evaluated for the hearing, because deafness can be a complication. And tuberculosis also notorious to cause basal meningitis. So tell me, doctor, a few indications where steroid need to be introduced, not just to the anti-TB or antibacterial therapy. H influenza meningitis is the place where not only antibiotics, steroid should be introduced, pneumococcal also. And also in the case of the TB meningitis also, we have to introduce the steroid, otherwise the patient goes into cranial nerve palsies as a complication of this basal meningitis is what need to be remembered. E. coli can cause, especially in the case of the neonates, the development of meningitis. H. influenza can infect the infants and toddlers. And pneumococcal, classically cerebral convexities is the place. And those who have a basal skull fracture, they are highly vulnerable to develop the pneumococcal meningitis. And Neisseria meningitis can be epidemic. It can also lead to development of adrenal hemorrhage called as the Waterson-House-Fredrickson. Then when the meningitis is very fulminant, then it can go into the ventricles. It can produce ventriculitis, which can cause ventricular enlargement and hydrocephalus development. If you happen to look in the CT, is what you can be able to see here. So that was one of the options. Will it cause ventricular enlargement? Very much it can cause. And this is how a tuberculoma sometimes can present parenchymal involvement. It can be mistaken for a tumor. And what is special about cryptococcal meningitis? Granulomatous meningitis is a very important feature, which is seen in the case of the cryptococcal meningitis. What is important about herpes encephalitis? These are all the spotters before the exam. So classically it involves the temporal lobes. That's the reason patient will have forgetfulness, he will become totally demented, etc. They can be the presenting features of herpes encephalitis because of the temporal lobe involvement, where there will be hemorrhagic necrotizing infection which can occur with the herpes encephalitis. Cytomegalovirus can cause encephalitis, especially in immunocompromised individuals. It can cause is what need to be remembered. Now let's go to the next question. UTI, urinary tract infection. You have a patient of intensive care unit has developed a UTI. Can one single factor can decide what type of organisms are most common? History of catheterization. The total flora leading to UTI in a catheterized individual is different from non-catheterized individuals, which is a common question in the exam. So typically, doctor, non-catheter associated UTI means it's a community acquired one. So there, it is the E. coli which is the most common. Proteus, Klebsiella, occasionally Enterobacter are the other important organisms. If you take the catheter associated, even here also, the E. coli is quite common, but you also have enterococci, candida, staphylococci, serratia, they also be the part of the picture. Now I will give a short presentation. The patient had a prolonged fever, cough and 2 month history of fever, and he is HIV infected for a chronic illness. Now one of the options I think was nocardia. In this context, let us talk about nocardia. It has nothing to do with UTI, it has to do something else. We are talking about that case. He is HIV infected individual, chronic illness, fever is there, cough is there. Then on radiograph you can see the presence of the lung abscess, subacute pneumonia consolidation. In a HIV positive individual, think of nocardiosis. When the needle aspiration had been done, how does nocardiosis will present itself, doctor? The beaded, branched, weakly gram-positive rods which are acid fast. Not only TB, even mycobacterium, even nocardia is one of the acid fast species is what need to be remembered. Sebarots, dextrose agar is the place where you want to grow it. And brain heart infusion agar is the place where you want to culture it and make it grow. So pneumonia and disseminated disease, brain can be involved, lung can be involved, brain abscess can form with the, lung abscess can form with the nocardia is what has to be basically remembered. So this is how the gram-positive aerobic nocardia asteroids can present with that beaded appearance is a classical feature. And it is acid fast, typically the nocardia, you can be able to clearly see. It can be very extensive, thick exudates can form with the pleurisy involving the thoracic wall. These are all the important features of the nocardiosis. And the nocardia can get disseminated, especially to the brain in an infective individual. So they are all the essentials about the nocardiosis. Now let's go to the next question. Chlamydia, already we discussed five important STD majors: syphilis, chancre, chancroid, you must be very sure about. So the non-gonococcal urethritis, epididymitis, what are the various manifestations of chlamydia? It can also cause rheitis, and proctitis can occur because of it, LGV, neonatal conjunctivitis, etc., etc. Whereas the options given, granuloma inguinale, typically beefy red lesions, classical picture of granuloma inguinale is caused by Kelimetobacterium granulomatosis, is what need to be remembered. Metabolic alkalosis, our favorite topic, has come back once more. All of you know, why will it happen? Every Sunday test we talk about, definitely about it. Patient is dehydrated, intravascular volume is contracted, that will decrease the renal perfusion, that will stimulate the renin, aldosterone, aldosterone causes sodium retention, potassium loss, H plus loss into urine, loss of H plus into urine leads to metabolic alkalosis, like a anthem, like a regular song, you must talk about it in the wards. Now, the question is, there is a second way by which metabolic alkalosis can occur. Kahn syndrome is there, adrenal is producing a lot of aldosterone, and that aldosterone also causes the same thing. So hyperaldosteronism can be primary or secondary. So naturally, if I have severe vomiting or if I am receiving a furosemide therapy, then I am losing all the chloride into the urine, and also I am dehydrated. If you give saline, I become, my metabolic alkalosis become treated. So we have to talk extensively the today's session before we call it a day. Bartter syndrome, Gittleman syndrome, Liddle syndrome, favorite topic of examiner, and milk alkali syndrome. What is happening in milk alkali? Are we finding milk alkali syndrome in the modern era, doctor? Once upon a time you have ulcer wins, drink milk of magnesia until you die with milk alkali syndrome. But nowadays we have powerful proton pump inhibitors, we are having antihistaminic agents, etc., etc. Almost it has got extinct, only remaining in the question banks, that's all. So large amounts of the calcium will lead to that, and that can also lead to development of metastatic calcification of renal failure, the milk alkali syndrome. Now what will happen if the calcium carbonate, bicarbonate, which is a part of your milk alkali to take care of the peptic ulcer, once upon a time when it is taken, what will happen? The absorption will be complete in about 4 hours, and the avid absorption of this calcium will lead to suppression of PTH. Normally hypo or hyper will, calcemia will stimulate PTH, doctor? Hypo. So more calcium means what should happen? Suppression of PTH should happen. And suppression of PTH in turn will cause the kidneys to retain bicarbonate, because PTH has a lot of effects. It will cause calcium reabsorption to be improved, point number one. It will cause phosphaturia to occur. It will also indirectly cause bicarbonaturia to occur. And if there is no PTH or decreased PTH, nobody to cause bicarbonate to be lost in the tubules, it become reabsorbed, and that lead to bicarbonate building. That is the relationship between taking calcium and developing excess bicarbonate and alkalosis in milk alkali syndrome, is what we need to basically understand. Another problem that hypercalcemia created by taking the milk of magnesia is, typically this hypercalcemia will go and affect the renal concentrating defect. Kidney loses its ability to retain water and concentrate the urine. So it in fact creates a kind of nephrogenic diabetes insipidus like state, your excess calcium which occurred in milk alkali. And individual lose a lot of water in the urine. just like a diabetes insipidus patient. He become dehydrated, he become volume depleted. In turn, this dehydration will further worsen the hypercalcemic state, because hypercalcemia means solute by solvent. If I am dehydrated, then solvent is less, so hypercalcemia concentration will further worsen. Then this becomes a cyclical process. The calcium ingested going and causing inhibition of PTH, PTH causing diabetes insipidus like state and making patient to become dehydrated, and that in turn causes further worsening of hypercalcemia, becomes a huge cyclic process. Now how do you take care of this? Discontinue that calcium carbonate patient is taking and try to keep the doses not more than 1200 to 1500 milligrams, and try to convert the calcium supplementation to any other form of calcium, gluconate like that, rather than calcium carbonate kind of form. If the patient has got a severe hypercalcemia because of this, what do? You first give a lot of saline and then give furosemide. Saline diuresis is the best way to take care of hypercalcemic state, right? So saline diuresis is sodium chlorate administration, saline loading, and then inducing diuresis are part of the management of milk alkali syndrome. That's the reason the option C also typically become a true statement, where we use a lot of chloride saline we infuse, and that will take care of this alkalosis in the dehydrated patient. Now we are left with the next important thing called the Bartter syndrome. Basically Bartter syndrome, Liddle syndrome, Gittleman syndrome, they are all the problems with the renal tubules at various levels. We need to know a few things. What ions become hypo, which ions become hyper, will there be acidosis, alkalosis, and will there be hypertension or a normal BP or a hypotension? What complications can occur out of these three syndromes? Bartter, Gittleman, Liddle's, these three syndromes, let us master it. Basically Bartter and Gittleman syndrome, doctor, they are the renal tubular salt wasting disorders, and the kidneys are unable to reabsorb the chloride. Normally where is chloride reabsorbed? Thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. That is one place. Second is distal convoluted tubule is another place where it become reabsorbed. It doesn't happen in these syndromes. Now what is the problem in Bartter? Originally Bartter described two African American patients who had a problem of slow growth, weakness, fatigue, and a small child who is a 5-year-old. What he observed was, this particular patient has got excess aldosterone, he has got hypokalemia and alkalosis. Naturally, if there is a lot of aldosterone, we can expect hypokalemia only, because aldosterone will cause sodium retention, potassium loss, H plus loss. So hypokalemic alkalosis is there, hyperaldosteronism is there, and this child is also having juxtaglomerular apparatus. It has undergone hyperplastic. Normally juxtaglomerular apparatus produces renin, which is responsible for that, all that excess aldosterone. So then he got almost the major clues why this patient is having all this. And this patient, when he was placed on a high sodium diet, then he developed a normal blood pressure and a high urinary aldosterone excretion he was showing. So this combination was described as the Bartter. So these are the Bartter babies who were being described by Landau. So the typical facial appearance, prominent forehead, triangular face, drooping mouth, large eyes, large pinnae, this is the typical. They also have a growth disturbance problem. Now how do you explain Bartter? Bartter is autosomal recessive in its inheritance. It's a renal tubular problem. There's a hypokalemia, hypochloremia, metabolic alkalosis, hyperreninemia, but there is a normal BP. This combination is called the Bartter. What is happening in them? Why they have hypochloremia? They are losing chloride in the urine. It is not getting reabsorbed at the level of the distal tubule and the thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. They are losing the sodium. They are also losing potassium. And all the three were there. Generally, what do you expect? Those states where potassium is lost, sodium is retained. Or if sodium is lost, potassium is retained. One or the other should happen. Both of them are lost. What is the reason? fundamental genetic defect is sodium and chloride is not reabsorbed and it is lost. And because of this problem, there is a stimulation, because of the sodium being lost and chloride being lost, there is a stimulation for juxtaglomerular apparatus to produce lot of renin, lot of aldosterone. That aldosterone actually is causing the potassium also lost. So hence the effect they are losing, sodium chloride which is the primary event, and excess aldosterone and loss of potassium and hypokalemia is the secondary event out of it, is what we have to fundamentally understand. That is also the reason. Generally, if individual has a high aldosterone level, what do you expect? Hypertension or normal blood pressure? You expect hypertension, but they have a normal blood pressure, which is a very, very important feature that clinches the diagnosis of the Bartter syndrome. Second, if an individual is losing sodium and chloride into the urine continuously, salt is lost, what do you expect? Hypotension. So they don't have hypotension because of loss of NaCl, or they don't have hypertension because of excess aldosterone, they have normal BP. Probably both of them are compensating, is what you can say. So there are basically mutations why that thick ascending limb of loop of Henle and distal tubule, they gone mad in Bartter's. They have a mutation, 5 distinct genes, which are the ones which will decide the ion channels and transporters which mediate the transepithelial salt reabsorption at the level of the distal renal tubule. That is the place where they are having the problem. Now let us look at the normal kidney. You have the lumen, you have the sodium and chloride transporter, which is the one which is dragging the sodium and chloride into the, from the lumen, renal lumen, tubular lumen, into the cell, into the blood. And this is the one which is basically defective in the case of the Gittleman syndrome, one of the variant of the Bartter. Now, basically the Bartter syndrome individuals are being divided into 3 main clinical varieties. One fellow is called the normal Bartter, other is called the classic Bartter, third is called the Gittleman. Basically these 3 are the variants of the same scenario. Only they differ in the type of receptor which is abnormal in them. In Gittleman syndrome, basically the problem is there at the level of the distal convoluted tubule. And there is one important transporter, co-transporter called sodium chloride co-transporter. They are, sodium and chloride are like the twin sisters, they walk together. So that is the main problem. Now in the case of the type 1 Gittleman syndrome, there is a problem in what is called the sodium potassium 2 chloride co-transporter at the level of the thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. Then in the case of the type 2 type of Bartter syndrome, you have the problem once more in thick ascending limb of loop of Henle with what is called as the CLC family of the chloride channels. Then in the type 3 Bartter syndrome, typically you have the problem with one of the receptors. Once more, Bartter basically is the problem at thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. Gittleman is the problem at the level of the distal convoluted tubule. And what is the problem? Problem is with the sodium chloride reabsorption. At least that much is essential for entrance. Now, in which part of our nephron is the chloride reabsorbed, doctor? Generally, body has wonderful mechanism. If you miss the bus in June entrance, you can catch it in December entrance. So also kidney has for chloride 2 locations. What is the June for the chloride? Chloride is passively reabsorbed at the proximal tubule. Then if it fails to get reabsorbed, it will prepare well and then get actively reabsorbed at the level of thick ascending limb of loop of Henle and distal convoluted tubule. You can say distal convoluted tubule is finally Manipal state entrance. At least you can pay a couple of lakhs and then join the MD. Worst scenario. So you must be prepared for any kind of eventuality, right? Finally, all MDs are equal, doctor, before the eye of the patient. Now the question is, suppose if there is a failure to reabsorb the chloride, that will typically lead to excessive amount of the sodium chloride reaching the distal tubule, and it is beyond the ability of the distal convoluted tubule to reabsorb all that. What is not reabsorbed at TALH cannot be completely reabsorbed at the level of the distal tubule. That is the rule. And that is the reason they lose basically the sodium and chloride into the urine. Now when there is no sodium chloride, that will stimulate the renin angiotensin system, which will lead to juxtaglomerular apparatus hyperplasia. Electron microscopically you can see the hyperplastic JGA. Now the question is, Why these Bartter's patients are normotensive, though they have a high angiotensin renin system? This angiotensin 2 is a vasoconstrictive agent. And that is the reason, at least though the sodium chloride is lost into urine, still patient is not going to hypotension because of it. Now why there is a growth inhibition? We have seen that the babies are having different growth retardation morphology. What is the reason? This angiotensin 2 is a powerful renal vasoconstrictor, and that will cause a counter-regulatory values of the prostaglandin levels too, which are the vasodilators, their levels to become increased. It is this increased prostaglandins which are implicated to be responsible for all that growth retarded features that we come across in the case of the Bartter syndrome. Now Bartters have got a high proclivity to develop nephrocalcinosis, renal stones. So what is the reason for it? Once more, aldosterone is the thief everywhere. High levels of aldosterone that is seen in Bartter, basically it will act on the potassium H plus ion exchange mechanism. Basically there is a potassium, H plus sodium. These three are very closely knit. Sodium is reabsorbed, potassium H plus is lost. So typically, doctor, when there is a high amount of aldosterone, it will make the H plus ion prevented from getting reabsorbed. And that is the reason any point of time, if you look into the tubular cell, H plus ion, instead of going into the interstitium, it will remain within the cell and ready to jump into the tubular fluid. When that intracellular H plus ion concentration is very high in the renal tubule, tubules will burn out. But there is a defense for that. What is that? The citrate which is there intracellularly, that become utilized in order to buffer this high H plus concentration which is there inside the tubular cell. And that will cause a relatively less amount of citrate appearing in the tubular fluid because it is already exhausted within the cell. And the low citrate in urine is a risk factor for the renal stone formation. That is the reason. Summarize, doctor. Patients with Bartter lose their NaCl. Losing NaCl stimulates the juxtaglomerular apparatus. That will make more aldosterone. Aldosterone will cause intracellular acidosis in the renal tubular cell. And that will exhaust the citrate. No citrate in the tubular fluid. Hypocitraturia is a risk factor for developing the renal stones, which is a complication of the Bartter, is what need to be remembered. Then why these patients have a metabolic alkalosis in the case of the Bartter? Once more, the same rule. The sodium which is excessively delivered is the one which will interfere with the potassium H plus ion reabsorption, and that is the reason they lose a lot of H plus into the urine, leading to metabolic alkalosis, is what has to be remembered. Now these patients with Bartters have also another reason why they develop nephrocalcinosis. Not only that citrate is low, even they have a high calcium in their urine. There is another factor which will make renal stones to be much higher in those who are having the Bartter syndrome. Now let us talk about why these patients have hypercalciuria. Normally there is a relationship between the chloride ions in the renal distal tubule and the calcium reabsorption. There is a relation between the two. That's how the whole linkage comes. Normally the reabsorption of these chloride ions from the renal tubular lumen into the cell will promote the lumen positive voltage, and this lumen positive voltage is a driving force for the positive calcium ion to become typically reabsorbed. The moment NaCl is not reabsorbed, this lumen positivity is not maintained, there is no driving force for the calcium reabsorption, hence calcium will slip into the renal tubular lumen and there is a calciuria. So that calciuria, same time with hypocitraturia, is the predisposing factor for the development of the renal stones, is what need to be remembered. Now this hypercalciuria is a very important differentiating feature between that of the Gittleman's variant versus that of the Bartter. Unlike the Bartter, where you see hypercalciuria, in Gittleman what you see is hypocalciuria, That is a differentiating factor between the two. One of the commonly asked questions in the exam, if at all you want to differentiate on which important single factor you differentiate between the two, Bartter and that of the Gittel man. So why in the case of the Gittel man this problem is there? Because calcium is also is usually reabsorbed in the distal convoluted tubule where the pathology is lying in the case of the Gittel man, and because of that the calcium is not lost into the urine, and there is a hypocalciuria unlike the Bartter where there is a hypercalciuria is what you need to remember. Another single differentiating factor between Gittel man and Bartter is hypomagnesemia. You may or may not find hypomagnesemia in Bartter, but hypomagnesemia is a classical feature in the case of the Gittel man, is another important differentiating feature. Now a very important question comes, as a MD general medicine you come across Bartter or MD pediatrics you come across? Bartter is typically found in little elderly, more prenatal type. Pediatrician finds it. So antenatally, during childhood with a growth retardation, patient can come first time to you. Where a Gittel man is found in the case of the early adulthood is what I like to underscore. Now how do you treat the Bartter? Reverse the pathophysiology. Patient is losing a lot of sodium, potassium and H+ ions into urine. So there's a reason, doctor. Sodium and potassium supplementation need to be given. All the excess aldosterone need to be taken care by giving spironolactone. You need to give ACE inhibitors to contract that excess angiotensin 2 which is there in them, and all the excess prostaglandins interfering with the growth need to be countered by giving indomethacin, give growth hormone to improve the stature of the individual, and give calcium and magnesium supplements to the individual. So the broad principles of managing a case of Bartter. Managing is easy, to diagnose is the real challenge. Growth retardation case you should think of possibility of the Bartter is the whole challenge. So neonatal Bartters, adult Bartters, Gittel mans, fundamentally we need to understand that the age of presentation is different. Polyhydramnios, failure to thrive, growth retardation, polyuria, polydipsia, they are all the features in Bartters. Whereas in the case of the Gittel man, hypomagnesemia will be there, that is the reason they develop muscle spasms, cramps, etc. much more commonly and characteristically. So whenever you have a patient, when do you suspect a case of Bartter or Gittel man or any of these syndromes, doctor? When the patient has got hypokalemia, renal potassium wasting, metabolic alkalosis with a normal blood pressure but a high renin aldosterone, look for his urinary calcium. If the urinary calcium is high, then you suspect Bartter, and if the urinary calcium is low, you suspect Gittel man. Check for the magnesium, serum magnesium is low, then it is Gittel man. If it is normal, then it is more commonly Bartter. That is how you fundamentally differentiate. So before we call a piece of the day, what are the 6 common questions asked in the exam, doctor? If you know this, you are a DM nephrology. Even DM nephrology entrance also same things will come. You have the dense disease, Bartter syndrome, familial hypocalciuric hypocalcemia, Liddle syndrome, Gittel man syndrome and X-linked hypophosphatemic rickets. Which part of the nephron are the problems lying? You must be doubly sure about. Bartters, now you are all experts in Barterology, right? Thick ascending limb of loop of Henle is Bartter, nowhere else. Then where do you find Gittel man, doctor? Distal convoluted tubule is the classical location, right? Then you have the familial hypocalciuric hypercalcemia. They don't lose calcium into urine, they retain it in the blood and they become hypercalcemic. Basically the problem is once more in the early part of the distal convoluted tubule and in the collecting duct level, they basically have the problem. Then you have the Liddle syndrome, another common question asked in the exam. They have typically once more at the level of the distal part of the distal convoluted tubule is the location where they have the problem. And the X-linked hypophosphatemic rickets, vitamin D resistant is a very important entity, vitamin D resistant rickets is a state where the problem is at the level of the proximal convoluted tubule. So you are very sure at least which channel is basically problematic.